Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. Our first item is to consider whether to take items 3 and 4 in private and whether to consider a draft legacy report and draft annual report in private at future meetings. Are members agreed? They are agreed. So we'll now move on to agenda item 2, which is evidence from the Equalities and Human Rights Commission and the Scottish Human Rights Commission for an annual update and overview of their priorities for the coming year, which do inform our legacy report for our successor committee. I'd like to welcome our first panel representing the Equality and Human Rights Commission in Scotland, John Wilkes, Head of Scotland, and Lynn Welsh, Head of Legal. There's an opportunity to make a brief opening statement, after which we'll move to questions from the committee. Over to you, John, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the committee for giving us the opportunity to share some of the work we've been doing and looking at our future priorities. And I'm here with my colleague, Lynn Welsh, who heads up all our legal and compliance work in Scotland, and between us, we lead the work of the Commission in Scotland. As I'm sure the committee is aware, the Equality and Human Rights Commission is Britain's equality regulator, and we are also an A-rated national human rights institution. However, in Scotland, we do share our human rights mandate with the Scottish Human Rights Commission and have a very good working relationship with them in that regard. Late last year, some new commissioners and a new chair were appointed to the commission. And in Scotland, we also recruited some new members to the commission's statutory Scotland committee. 2020 was set out to be a significant year for us in the Commission, with both the 10th anniversary of the Equality Act and the 50th anniversary of the Equal Pay Act, two very landmark pieces of legislation. Of course, other events overtook 2020, and like everybody else, we've been overshadowed with the impact of the COVID pandemic, and our thoughts are that its effects on equality are going to be with us for some time to come. Our work is dictated by our strategic plan priorities. Our current strategic plan covers the period 2019 to 2022. Our core aim is to ensure that strong equality and human rights laws work to protect people. In our current plan, we have 5 other priority aims covering equality challenges in things like access and fair treatment at work, education, public transport, fair treatment in institutions, and redress in the criminal justice system. When the impacts of COVID became clear about a year ago, we quickly reviewed our work and priorities. So on the back of that, we paused or reduced some work we had been planning to do in the year just gone, particularly around education and transport. We quickly noted the impact that COVID seemed to be having on some communities, like BME communities, and its impact on care homes, on elderly and disabled people. And we have developed new priorities and programs of work to look at the equality aspects of these. In June last year, we launched an inquiry looking to the impact of COVID on low-paid workers in health and social care organizations who are from BME communities. And we've also developed a program of work to look at the impacts of COVID on the social care system through an equalities lens. And we anticipate that both these programs of work will continue into next year. We are obliged every 5 years to produce a sort of state of the nation report on how equality is doing across Britain and in Scotland, and we were due to publish that report later this year. However, we've decided to delay the publication of Is Scotland Fair by a year so that we can review and incorporate the evidence of the longer term impacts of COVID on equality. We felt that was important to do that. In October last year, we did publish a shorter report where we brought together evidence looking at the more immediate impact of how coronavirus was affecting equality and human rights, and that report did contain some recommendations for governments across Britain. We continue to prioritise the use of our unique legal powers and our compliance tools. We produced a range of guidance to support employers in dealing with different aspects of the pandemic. In June last year, we published the findings of an inquiry we took into the challenges of people with disability or who have mental health conditions in terms of navigating their way through the barriers they're facing the criminal justice system. Our strategic use of our legal powers last year included 2 Britain-wide investigations, one into anti-Semitism in the Labour Party and one into equal pay at the BBC. And in Scotland, we reached a settlement on a very significant case with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde on ending the unlawful detention of adults with incapacity. In terms of the policy work, we very much focused in the last year on working with policymakers, legislators to ensure that the fast changing environment of coronavirus and the policy regulations and legislation that were brought forward to meet those challenges ensured that they met the equality requirements of the equality legislation. Looking ahead to the coming year, as I said before, we will continue our work with our race inquiry that we started, and we anticipate to publish the findings of that in June. And we will further develop our work on the impact of COVID on the different aspects of our social care system. We will move to support the focus of equality and the important work of economic recovery. And this coming year, we will be looking at the impact of the pandemic, particularly in terms of women and work. We noted the Scottish Government's commitment to review the public sector duties, and we hope to be involved in that. And we're considering other work, such as a potential inquiry into the DWP on how aspects of its work impacts on people with disabilities. As this coming year is going to be the final year of our current strategic plan, we will be consulting on how priorities for our new strategic plan, due to come into effect in 2022, will go forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. That's very thorough and helpful. And I know committee members will be keen to probe you on some of those aspects of your work that you mentioned. I'll just go to the committee members for their questions now. And if I could bring in Gillian Martin, please. Gillian.
Yeah, I was going to ask about the impact that COVID-19 has had on your priorities for your work programme, but I think, John, you've covered that very well. So there's a couple of things in your opening statement that I would like to pick up on. You mentioned at the end there that you plan to do some work on women and work. And as we all know, there's been many reports that have come out that have said that women have been disproportionately disadvantaged by the COVID-19 pandemic. And a lot of that stretches back to the inequalities around women's work. I'm just wondering if you can give me a little bit more detail on what you're planning there.
Thank you, Gillian. John.
Sorry. Am I on now?
You are.
Correct. Sorry. Thank you. Well, the report I mentioned that we published in October, where we to look at some of the immediate impacts of COVID in terms of the labour market, the issues of the evidence are showing that there's increased underemployment rather than unemployment so far. Loss of earnings from that contribute to dropping living standards, and the groups most likely to be affected by that include women, but other groups as well. What we'll be doing in terms of looking at how we can help shine a light on some of those issues. Some of those are obviously longer standing issues in terms of pay or opportunities or flexible working. So we are going to pull together what we think would be a most appropriate package of work using our role as the equality regulator to advise both government employers in how they can address and tackle these issues. So we're still working on the final outlines of that work.
Thank you. Gillian.
Thank you. And with regard to you know, your capacity to carry out what sounds like a really intense programme of work, really important work that you've outlined in your opening statement, I mean, how has the pandemic so far impacted on the Commission's staffing and resourcing? I mean, you really are having to deal with quite a lot of the impacts, studying the impacts that COVID-19 is having, but of course, as an organisation, you might have been impacted yourself.
Yes, I mean, like any organisation, we've been working at home for about a year now. As I said in the opening statements, we very quickly had to review the work plan we had set out for the last year, and we paused some areas of work we'd been planning to do. We decided we would consider putting some pieces of work a year behind. Clearly, a lot of staff were impacted personally by the impact of coronavirus. So some staff had to reduce hours. And I suppose we faced exactly the same challenges as many organizations have faced. And what we've tried to do is scale up or scale down the work we felt we could do. And we also focused very much on what was most relevant now, being the equality regulator and a human rights institution, to play our part in shining a light on certain things that were going on in what was a very fast-moving, and still is a fast-moving pandemic. So yes, we have been impacted. We haven't been impacted particularly financially, if that was part of your question, but certainly staff capacity was affected like other organisations. But we've tried to adapt as best we can to that, and using modern technology as well to further the work.
Thank you, John. Lynn, I wonder if I can bring you in, if you've anything further to add to Gillian's questions there around the priorities and the impact COVID's had on your staffing and resourcing.
I don't think so. I think John's covered it really quite adequately there. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Gillian, are you content?
Yes, thank you, Convener.
Okay, I can bring in Joe Fitzpatrick, please. Joe.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the opening remarks, which gives us a good insight into how you've worked in relation to the pandemic. Looking at your business plan, though, as well as talking about facing the challenges and responding to the challenges of the pandemic, you also talk about tracking Brexit and what that means in terms of human rights. So I wonder if you can maybe just talk a little bit about that work.
John.
Certainly. Yeah, certainly. I think Lynn would be better placed to talk about that because she leads on some of that work for us in Scotland.
Thanks. Okay, Lynn.
Oh, thanks very much. It's something that we are still keeping a very close eye on. We obviously want to ensure that any equality or human rights issues or legislation that comes from Europe, it remains to protect the people of Britain. And so we are inputting to various consultations that are ongoing and just tracking, if you like, the effects of Brexit now that we have left the EU. So it's a sort of general tracking, I think, at the moment would the main thing that we're doing, yeah.
Joe.
Thanks for that. These are obviously two really big things for the Commission coming at the same time. Is that giving you scope to and capacity to look at other areas? You know, last year we had really significant protests around the Black Lives Matter, and are you having capacity to look at the human rights in the wider context, or are these two big issues just making it very difficult?
Lynn.
Thank you. We are involved in other quite large areas of work as well, which we're sort of juggling, I suppose, across the piece. Our interest, I suppose, is more equality than human rights. Our sister organisation will come after us, but we are very much and have been very much involved in looking at the incorporation of Scotland, which is quite a large piece of work here, that we've been feeding in sort of equality aspects to. The race inquiry, obviously, that John's already touched on, is part of our response to how COVID has affected the Black community. And aside from that, we're also looking at how best we can assist the Shaker Bayou in a public inquiry that's underway at the moment, as well as part of our sort of race piece of work.
John, do you wish to add anything to that?
I think they said, I mean, part of the reason that we decided to launch our race inquiry was on the back of not only the COVID impact, but we were aware, obviously, like everybody else, of the focus around Black Lives Matter. The inquiry, we felt, was the best way we could use our powers and tools and focus to contribute to this issue, which is why we chose to look at the impact we have. But we will obviously continue to monitor all of these things as we go forward.
Thank you. Joe, do you wish to come back in?
That's good, thank you.
Okay, if I can go to Alexander Stewart now, please. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener. John, in your opening remarks, you talked about the disadvantages and inequalities that different groups have had to identify. And the pandemic has meant that things have been done at speed and action needed to be taken quickly. So can I ask, on balance, do you think the Scottish Government has undertaken sufficient equality and human rights impact assessments on legislative and policy changes?
We've been working a lot with government over the last year. I think it's fair to say that our view would be it's been a mixed bag. I think when things happen at speed, some considerations might be more difficult to take into account. We've been talking to senior officials in the government about trying to ensure that the government across all its many functions ensures that when whatever policy or new legislation, whatever it is it's looking at, that it fulfills its obligations, particularly around the public sector equality duties. And we've pointed out areas where we felt that hasn't been, or we couldn't see where that had been taken into account. The government have been, on the whole, responsive and have come back to us in many of those areas. But yes, I would say overall, our sense would be that it's been variable.
And, you know, the importance of consultation with organisations like yourself is vitally important, and you have a key role to play. So have you had to ensure that that key role has been forced, or have, as you say, you've indicated, it's a bit of a mixed bag. So in amongst all of that, have there been areas that you felt that you maybe should have been consulted and given more information and given more support to ensure that the government was able to manage the process?
So it's obviously not our role to dictate how the government fulfills its responsibilities. What we've been trying to do is ensure that we've been helpful. We've tried to be helpful where we can in terms of helping them in certain areas which are new. We've pointed out where we felt that we didn't feel that they had exercised enough focus, and that's what we've. But there's been obviously quite a lot of activity on all sorts of fronts in this, and it's obviously been a lot of work involved in that. But I would have to say where we have had discussions, the response has generally been very, very positive, and steps have been taken to redress some things that we felt maybe hadn't been completed. But it isn't just about government, of course, the wider public sector has also had to deal with its responsibilities in this new environment. I don't know if Lynn wants to add anything. She leads up the compliance function, which would work with public authorities and the government more directly on some of these things. You might want to say anything.
Yes, I'm happy to add to what John's already said. As he said, yes, it's an area that we've kept a very close eye on over the last year, not only with government, but with others. We've taken very much a supportive role for the last short period, rather than a very regulatory one because of the emergency and obviously the difficulties that was producing. So we've been a bit more sort of hands-on help than we may normally be at the beginning of the pandemic. And we have produced extra guidance for organisations. I think, unsurprisingly, the pandemic has more shone a light on existing inequalities than shown new ones. And I think it's important perhaps to think about the data gaps that we have seen. I think this is quite a fundamental problem that we've found over the period specifically. That there's just not enough information being gathered about the people of Scotland, generally, in particular groups, so that we can found good equality impact assessments and decision making. So that's certainly an area that we see, I think, going forward needs a focus. And we're hoping to do a bit of work next year, or the coming, from April onwards year, to try and encourage others and ourselves to try and fill some of those data gaps, because it's been very clear that without that information, your decision making is difficult.
And as you identify, new lessons will be learned from this whole process. Government and others have said they maybe hadn't been as informed, or mistakes may have been made, and the same with some of the agencies and other bodies who were maybe caught on the hop. Because the priorities had to change. And I think that your organisation does have a role to play in trying to guide things for the future. And I think that is a role that you have. And how do you see that developing as time goes on?
Yeah, I think that's a fair comment. As I say, we are planning in the coming year to be doing more work around the public sector duties generally. There is a government review due in relation to those, and we've been doing our own work effectively, what we start looking at improving. The pandemic, as I say, has shone a light on some of the issues and the unpreparedness of all of us for some of the stuff that has turned up. So the PSD review and how to really embed the equality issues into organisations and their work is something that we're going to focus on quite substantially. For example, at the social care review, which has obviously come out if and when that turns into work after the election. We're very keen to discuss with the government at that point how you build equality into a new system, if a new system is to be produced, rather than simply have it as a here's a system and equality sits here, do remember to do your equality duties. But instead, can you sort of say when you're setting outcomes in your organisation, those automatically have integrated into them the equality issues that you need to be thinking about. You're building in your requirements to collect data. So we're hoping there may be an opportunity, if there is a new system to be built, to make it one that works fundamentally better.
Thank you, Convena.
Thank you. And I think committee would certainly recognise your comments there about data and also about equality being at the centre and not being something on the side. Now, I know Mary Fee is going to come in and ask some more questions on public sector equality duty, but I'd like to ask you about human rights. You refer to your involvement in the National Task Force on Human Rights Leadership, which is due to report in March. Are you able to provide any reflections for the committee on that? And if I can go to John.
Again, I would refer to Lynn on this one. She's been our lead on the work of the incorporation force.
Okay, thank you. Lynn, please.
Thank you. This is very front and centre, our sister organisation's piece of work, the Scottish Human Rights Commission. But we have, as we said earlier, been involved in the task force. And our main aim is to look at how that intersection between the incorporation of human rights conventions and equality, especially given that equality is to a great extent reserved, how that works most effectively. I think overall our view is that it's a great thing Scotland is leading on a marvellous piece of work to incorporate human rights directly into our systems. It is certainly something that we support across Britain as an organisation, and very much look forward to seeing the changes that can make over the next few years. I think the work that's been done has been very inclusive. There's been an awful lot of going out to different groups and parts of civil society to take views, as well as looking at academics, lawyers and those normally involved in these kind of situations. So we would certainly see that the task force has produced, hopefully produce a very good report out the end, which hopefully the government thereafter will take forward.
Thank you, Lynn. The UK government's currently reviewing the Human Rights Act, looking at whether it's working in practice and whether it needs to change. Will your organisation be submitting a response to that review? And if so, are you able to give committee a sense of what that response might look like?
Yes, we intend to respond to the consultation that's ongoing very broadly. I mean, we have not put in our response yet, so I wouldn't want to sort of jump the gun in relation to that. But I think the areas that they're looking at, the consultation relates to specifically, we, generally speaking, would not see a need to change. We think it works effectively as the legislation is at the present time.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. And if I can go to Mary Fee now, please, Mary.
Thank you, convener.
Public authorities have been asked to provide a statement if they're unable to provide their equality outcomes, which are required under the public sector equality duty by the end of April this year. I wonder if you could perhaps give the committee an update on how that's going. Have you had discussions with public authorities about delays to the PSED? And are you aware of the difficulties or any experiences that public authorities are having in attempting to complete them?
One of the challenges of this format who's making. I can see both John. Which of you would like to come in on that?
I think Lynn's best place to do this. She leads up on the compliance work with the public sector equality. So, yeah.
Okay, Lynn, please.
Sorry, John. Yeah. That was rid of me. Leaping in. Yes, we have been doing quite a lot of work with the public sector over the last few months to help them get ready for the reporting this year again in a way that we haven't always done. So, for example, from around October, November, December, we ran some specialist round tables for public sector to look at outcomes. Not only because it's a difficult thing in COVID, but because we wanted to see improvements in the way that outcomes were being set by public authorities. Overall, our understanding is that organisations will be producing the reports and the outcomes that they need to produce, even with COVID. We have not had substantial numbers of organisations saying that they will not be able to do that. I mean, we wrote out earlier in the year saying that we would expect that bodies would still be able to produce the reporting that they required to do, as did the government. And certainly the majority of feedback we've had is that people will be producing those reports as required.
So you're confident that all the reports will be completed on time?
I would never say all. yes, we're not. We have no feel at the moment that there are huge numbers of organisations unable to provide those. Certainly, those organisations who came to our round tables, and those included, you know, most health boards, most local authorities, the large organisations, were all intending to report within the proper time scales.
Okay, that's helpful. Lynn, you touched earlier on the review into the public sector equality duty and your involvement with that. I wonder if you could maybe talk a bit more about that, because the government have said that the review is getting done in two stages between now and the summer, an effectiveness report followed by the development of specific proposals. Could you talk to the committee a bit about your involvement in each of those? And if you think that the timescale that the government have set for this is achievable?
Can I pass this one back to John, if I may, because he's you work.
Thanks, Lynn. Thank you, Lynn. Yeah, we've been involved with the government since it first set out its intention to review the specific duties on the equality duty in Scotland for a couple of years. We did a review of the effectiveness of, from our perspective, of how the public sector equality duty has worked. We published that a couple of years ago. Obviously, COVID has intervened and delayed the original plans. We certainly have ongoing and regular discussions with government about the progress of their review, and we feel confident that we will be fully involved in that. We have our own thoughts about how we might be able to improve the functioning of the duties in Scotland. And the experience of the previous year we've just been through in COVID has helped to reinforce that, I think. Whether the process is doable is largely down to, of course, government who will be running the process. Obviously, there's an election in the middle of all of that, so I don't know how that will interfere with that. But so far, we've been fully involved. I think the government have wanted us to be involved in, as the regulator, in the thinking behind all of that. So I think we're confident certainly of our ability to be involved. Obviously, whether the thoughts we have are taken up, we will wait to see.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you, convener.
John, I wonder if I could Tricia, a tiny bit. Would you be able to give us some examples of some of the thoughts that you have around what could improve things?
Yes, we've been thinking about various aspects of how the duties are currently structured, whether, for example, the mainstreaming part of the duties, how effective is that? Lynn's already mentioned the issues of data gathering, and that is still something that, you know, is a big area of work for all public authorities to focus on. Whether public authorities can be more focused in terms of the equality outcomes they set, I think our experience of how the duty operates is that public authorities tend to set quite general approaches to their equality outcomes. We don't think that that's always the most effective way. We think public authorities could be bolder in terms of using the evidence they have to look at the period that they're looking at and say, for this period, we're actually going to focus on these particular areas. So there are aspects of that. How do we make the duties work better to achieve those goals is obviously something that we need to think more about. But those are some of the areas. Again, I don't know if Lynn's got any more thoughts to add to that.
Lynn?
I think outcomes is probably one of our main focuses, as you're probably gathering, simply because that is the bit that we think where you can make a real difference to people on the ground, which is what this is for. Sometimes it feels a bit, you collect information, doesn't much happen with it kind of stuff. But the outcome area is one that we see as can make a fundamental difference. And I think we're looking to perhaps have a system whereby government can set or identify the biggest inequalities in Scotland in health or in social care or whatever area it is that you're looking at. And that the organisations who are working in that area, the public authorities, can then draw down almost the outcomes that they should be setting for the 4 years to change that situation. So this is very much more focused on measurable change, so we can come back in 4 years and sort of go, yes, this has improved, whether it's attainment in universities or health records, whatever, and actually track the kind of change, and the government would be able to do that as well. So we do, I think, need to see a lot more focus on measurement of outcomes, on perhaps having less but more important ones. We see generally outcomes are set saying all the people of Scotland will get a better service from us is almost how it's done. That is not an equality outcome. It's not looking at particular inequalities. It's not looking at a particular protected characteristics. So I think that whole area is one that we see has real power if it's done properly. And we've done little pieces of work, for example, with the Scottish Funding Council, where we're looking at trying to use that kind of model. So the government sort of saying these are the outcomes we expect further and higher bodies, education bodies to achieve. And the Scottish Funding Council and us then going to sort of say, right, here are almost your equality outcomes set for you. We'll then be coming through and helping you to measure those to see the change that you achieve. Hopefully, I mean, COVID has put a slight delay on this, but that is our hope, that we can see that working in one area and perhaps then extend a model.
Thank you. That's helpful. I think that's key, isn't it, that qualities and human rights work has to be evident and making a difference to the people who it's for and who are experiencing it there, rather than just be a nice thing to talk about. Okay, if I could go to Alison Harris now, please.
Morning, committee. The committee has made calls this session for the development of human rights budgeting. The recent Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement outlines the 10 key risks to progressing national outcomes as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic and the EU exit, and considers how policy and activity funded by the budget will respond to these challenges. So I would like to ask whether you support this approach, well, obviously a new approach, and do you think that the Scottish Government is making progress in the equalities and human rights budgeting? I don't know who would like to answer.
I'm happy to go first, if that's okay. This is obviously, the concept is not necessarily new. There's been a focus on a quality budget aspects for a number of years, and we've been part of those discussions and groups to help advise government on what the focus is. More recently, the wider focus of equality and human rights budgeting is something, I mean, the general concept is something we would support. On the human rights aspects of it, our sister commission, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, have been much more involved in that aspect. It's part of their mandate. So I think that would be something more to direct at them for the human rights side. Again, I think in terms of how has it been progressing, I think, again, it's slow burner, I would say. I think learning has to go on all the time about how you do ensure that in the allocation of your resources that you're taking in consideration what the impact of that is going to be on different groups in society, what evidence do you have to help support that. So there's some work that's been done, but there's still some work to go. Again, I don't know if Lynn wants to add anything to that.
Okay, no, thanks.
Alison, do you have any follow-up on
no,
that?
No, thank you. No, that's interesting. Thank you.
Okay, and I don't see any other committee colleagues wishing to. So that brings us to the end of evidence from this panel. Many thanks to John Wilkes and Lynn Welsh. It's been very informative for committee. Thank you for your time. We'll now suspend briefly while we prepare our second panel. Welcome back and good morning to our second panel representing the Scottish Human Rights Commission. We have Judith Robertson, Chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and Dr. Alan Mitchell, Commissioner. Judith, if I could invite you to make an opening statement for the committee, please.
Good morning. Very good to see you this morning. Thank you greatly for the invitation to come and give evidence to you today. As you know, just briefly by way of introduction, we are Scotland's A-status independent national human rights institution. The A-status means that we work in a way which complies with the law that governs the practice of national human rights institutions around the world, the Paris Principles, and it means that we are deemed to be primarily, in that line, independent of government, parliament, and able to work on behalf of the people of Scotland in relation to our human rights mandate. We're a body of the United Nations and exist really because the UN recommended that states would benefit from having national human rights institutions to support the development of human rights in their own state. As you're aware, we have a foundation in national law, which is our legislation, and that law gives us a range of different powers, and including that of our general mandate. Our general mandate is to promote human rights and to build on best practice in relation to human rights, and our powers specifically enable us to intervene in civil cases in relation to human rights in Scotland, and to undertake public inquiries. And in the context of a public inquiry, enter a place of detention. We're the only Scottish organisation, as a result of our A status, that can make direct contributions to the Human Rights Council at the UN on issues affecting people in Scotland. We act as a bridge between human rights in Scotland and the international human rights system, and we monitor the implementation of international human rights treaties as they apply in Scotland. We work closely with civil society and others to gather evidence and produce recommendations to do that. Just that's by way of introduction to what the Commission is. The convener said, I am the chair of the Commission. Dr. Alan Mitchell is one of three other commissioners who work in partnership to oversee the Commission's work and guide our strategy and development. In the last period, I think the last time I gave evidence to the Parliament, we were in the final stages of preparing our strategic plan. That was some 18 months ago, nearly 2 years ago, and we're now at the very end of the first year of our new strategic plan. We have four strategic priorities on the basis of that plan. Our first priority is to progress understanding and strengthen legal protections around economic, social and cultural rights. Our second priority is around strengthening accountability and meeting international human rights obligations. Our third priority is building wider ownership of human rights. And our fourth priority is advancing best practice locally and sharing our learning globally. Now, I won't at this point go into a big elucidation of those priorities, because I suspect that's what will come out as our discussion unfolds. But it's safe to say that even after year one, I think we're making significant progress in relation to these strategic priorities. And I can talk as we go through the session about how we're doing that.
Thank you, Judith. That's really helpful. I'll go to questions now. And Gillian Martin, please.
Thank you. And thank you, Judith, for that introduction, which leads me nicely on to talking about the impact of COVID-19. Every organisation has had to reprioritise, and I would imagine none more so than a human rights organisation, as things develop in this pandemic, which has an impact on people's human rights and equalities. And I wonder, just in the last year where we've been going through this, how that has reset your priorities and your work programme?
Well, you're absolutely correct in assessing that the instance of COVID has made a huge impact on our work programme. We made a statement back in March 2020, which was right at the very beginning of the pandemic or beginning of lockdown for Scotland, advocating that human rights standards guide the responses to the pandemic in Scotland. And in the course of the unfolding of all the different dimensions of the pandemic, we made a series of interventions and briefings and recommendations to government across a whole range of work areas to really illustrate how human rights are being impacted, where are being impacted by the pandemic. That started particularly with the emergency legislation, because as we know, the emergency legislation, both at UK level and then following on at the, at the Scottish level, brought in some under the banner of a piece of emergency legislation, some very extraordinary, I would say, in peacetime restrictions on people's movement and activities. And as we all know, the rationale for that was very much around protecting the right to life. And so, you know, there was a legitimate and a basis for that intervention. But as we made comment back then, we felt some of those interventions or some of the restrictions were inappropriate, maybe too blanketly applied, and needed to be unpacked a little from a human rights perspective explicitly, so that they could be moderated and managed over the period of the pandemic. So, I mean, I can go in, Alan will talk, Dr. Mitchell will talk at some length about the work in relation to prisons, but I think it would be useful to just give you a brief overview of the different work areas that we actually focused on in relation to the pandemic, because I think it serves two things: both the range of issues that that the pandemic impacts on, but also the range of issues that the Commission is able to respond to. So I think it serves both those purposes. So Alan, I'll bring Alan in to talk about prisons in just a minute, but just so again, so you know, we as well as doing a lot of work around prisons and what was both the regulatory framework as to what permissions prison governors were given, but also the actually was happening in prisons, that was important. We also engaged in the independent advisory group on police use of temporary powers. So we were part of still part of the John Scott QC chaired group that monitors how the police are using the powers that they have. We gave a very robust, I would say, complete analysis of the human rights issues at stake. Initially, and then laterally, brought that up to date when in a different areas around peaceful protests and assembly, because obviously the police were having to deal during Black Lives Matter and other dynamics through the process of the pandemic, deal with protest, which was quite challenging in the sort of social distancing times. And so the rights that they had to work on were very much part of what we were talking about. And in fact, it was one of our other commissioners, Susan Kemp, who led on that work on behalf of the Commission. We also produced clinical guidance for the Chief Medical Officer in relation to the ethical support framework that they put in place way back at the beginning of the pandemic in relation to decisions being made about people's treatment and care. And provided a human rights perspective in relation to that, which was, as I understand, very influential in revising the clinical guidance and producing a more, I would say, human rights respecting guidance to, you know, health and social care workers taking decisions daily on people's lives. We worked closely with the Mental Welfare Commission to develop a human rights framework for scrutiny of the use of the emergency powers in relation to adults and incapacity. That was one area where we had specific concerns that the legislation itself had the potential to overreach in relation to what was appropriate in terms of people's rights. In fact, those powers were never used, which was a good thing in our view. And in September, the Commission welcomed the expiry of those powers in legislation. We did a lot of work around social care and following the introduction of the Coronavirus Act, we could see that social care was and continues to be an area where people's rights to both care and the right to be involved in decisions around their care was at serious jeopardy. And we saw, we produced a report, we did a whole monitoring exercise and produced a report which basically outlined, as with other stakeholders, really how much local authorities had felt they had to limit the care packages for people, often without any consultation with either the individuals themselves or their families and carers, and that was causing considerable human rights breaches. So that's something which we continue to be concerned about, and you know, will impact on our work going forward. If I could, there are other areas I'll touch on, but I'd like to sort of pause there and maybe either open up for questions on that or bring Dr. Alan Mitchell in just to talk about the prison engagement.
Thank you. That's really helpful. I'll bring Gillian Martin back in a minute. I know that Joe Fitzpatrick will have some questions around the work on the prison population, so we'll pause bringing Alan in. This isn't too confusing, hopefully. I'm keeping a track of it. So if we go back to Gillian for her follow-up questions, and then when we move on to Joe, we can talk about prisons. Gillian.
To be honest, I'm quite keen for colleagues to come in, because colleagues are going to come in on a range of things, picking up on what some of the detail of what's there. But I just wondered if Judith, she wants to come back in and say that there was other work priorities as well, and maybe just sort of like allow her to finish off on that so that my colleagues can dig in on that.
Fine. So, I mean, in line, I suppose, with our overall strategic priorities, when we looked at our strategic priorities at the beginning of the pandemic to say, well, how is that? Do we have to effectively rewrite our strategic plan in order to deal with this issue? And we actually looked and said, no, we don't. The issues that were the broad issues that we're looking at in relation to this plan are still very relevant. They absolutely apply. Strengthening people's protections in relation to economic social rights is absolutely at the core of what was at stake in the pandemic. Accountability and that aspect of accountability where actually holding duty bearers to account was absolutely both what we were actively doing in a number of areas, as I talked about the policing dimension, and as I say, Alan will talk about prisons, and government more broadly, to say you have a duty for these, an obligation for these responsibilities to be overseen in line with their human rights obligations. So we also then prepared a number of briefings in relation to some specific areas around economic and social rights. I touched on the social care piece, and we also did a briefing in relation to care homes, which was also obviously an important area where there were significant concerns about impact of the pandemic in care homes to a very severe extent. So we unpack that as well from a human rights perspective, and prepared a briefing which really outlined what the duties were for the government and duty bearers, public authorities in relation to those issues. But we also wanted to highlight the broader issues in relation to economic rights, social rights more broadly, about the right to health and the right to food, which also became quite an acute issue for a lot of people over the period of the pandemic. And then the right to housing. So we prepared briefings on all of these areas in order that both not just the government and the public authorities, but civil society organisations as well, were able to bring the rights framework and rights themselves into the conversations they were having with other duty bearers, with other civil society, or with funders. And really to say, and I could see that peppered throughout some of the analysis that I saw, particularly around the right to food, where food being provided with dignity, what that takes, what food banks are not considered a rights compliant means of providing food to people. And we saw the government boost funding strategies so that direct cash payments through the welfare fund could be made to people, and that being a much more rights-respecting way of ensuring that people's right to an adequate standard of living and the right to food could be realised on the ground in communities, people having dignity, having choice, having the ability to use the funds that they were being provided on what they felt were the best things for them, which is always a better way of doing it than actually providing food. You know, that's not internationally, globally, that would not be deemed to be the best way to do it. So again, I'm using an example, but to illustrate the kind of range of things we were covering.
Yeah, and I think it's very apparent listening to you, what impact you've had, and also how you've informed many parliamentarians' questions and challenges to some of the coronavirus legislation as it's unfolded. So thank you very much for that. And Convener, I'll hand back to you.
Thank you, Gillian. Judith, looking at there's never going to be a bright side to any of this, where so many lives have been lost. However, you know, clearly we can, you know, lessons can be learned, and we can make things better for the future. Do you think that the inputs that you've had in terms of taking a human rights approach to these you know, various strands that impact on the lives of our citizens, do you think that there might be opportunity for sort of more progression, because people have seen on the ground the difference that taking a human rights-based approach can make to our citizens? Does that make sense?
Yes, it totally makes sense. And I would say absolutely I agree with you, the bright side, there is no bright side, but in the context from a human rights perspective, it has given us, it's enabled us to actually demonstrate to people how rights can enable their decision-making in really challenging contexts. And if they take a rights-based approach, that just decision-making can be balanced, it can be respectful, it can bring people into the room in a way that in an equal way. As you know, underpinning the rights framework are a series of principles around participation in decision making that affect your lives, around accountability, around being able to hold duty bearers to account. These are really important components of the framework. And I saw time and again civil society organisations, parliamentarians themselves, all sorts of key public authorities using human rights to help them guide some of their decision making and inform, and also I have to say give us a platform to say to them, actually you need to do this. This isn't you're not doing enough of this. You actually need to be bringing human rights much more solidly into what you're doing. But the other thing I would say is not just about what has happened, but what will happen. And that heightened awareness has done for me a number of things, as well as increasing, I think, people's general understanding of the rights framework and how it can be brought into play appropriately and meaningfully, both in the Parliament and externally. There's a number of key places going forward where I think that human rights can also continue to play a really enabling role. One is around how we make policy and how we do our budgeting process. So I didn't mention one other area of work where we also supported the Parliament to look at our budgeting processes from a human rights perspective, and to really give guidance to the Parliament. So you need to think about human rights when we're looking at the pandemic budget. It's like, where is money being applied? Is it being applied and the principal beneficiaries are only people who are already got money, or is actually being applied in such a way that it is genuinely supporting those who are the most vulnerable, the most caught, the most impacted by the pandemic in economic and social terms? So that was felt, and I would say it's also been taken on as we look forward to come out of the pandemic and you know, rebuild both our institutions and our policy making as we go forward. That's a really important component of what we've done. There was something else I was going to say in response to your question, Convener. I can't remember. It'll come back to me. There's a lot that from our perspective. Oh, yes. Sorry. The other final area is in the public inquiry. So it's not final, there'll be others, but the public inquiry is a key area where we feel that it needs to be extensive. Obviously, the framing of it is still being developed. We understand why it's not happening yet, but it obviously needs to happen. But that needs to take a rights-based approach as well. It needs to be built on an understanding of what rights were at stake, were at play, how rights were realised or not, how rights were respected in decisions up front, That the way that public inquiry is undertaken is also taking a rights-based approach, that the people most affected by the pandemic are the people most impacted, the families of those who died, those people whose livelihoods were completely cut away from them, the people who for whom care homes and visits, etc., were termed stopped. You know, there's a whole range of people. I mean, actually a huge range of people that the public inquiry will need to take into their discussions and ensure that their participation is real within that process and that it's built on their experience. It's not just from the perspective of the state organisations who were doing the work, that actually looks at those people's experience of what happened. Now, I mean, public inquiries are effectively required to do that, but really making that a rights-based approach is crucial going forward.
Thank you. Yes, and the committee would be in total agreement with that, I can say safely. Okay, I'll move on to Joe Fitzpatrick now, please. Joe.
Thanks, convener. Obviously, that was a really helpful overlay, Judith, and some of the detail was really useful. So it's maybe covered some of my question. There was kind of two areas I was mostly wanting to ask about, and it's areas that you've had a priority on in relation to mental health, which I think you've covered some of that in terms of the adults with incapacity. And the other area, as the convener has said, was around the prison population. Obviously, here we have a population which relies on the rest of us to protect their human rights just by the nature. So it's been really good that the focus that you've placed on that. So good to hear from John, an outline of the work that has been done through the pandemic, maybe a bit about how the focus has changed as the pandemic's moved on. And I'd be keen to hear as well about whether some of the lessons that we've learned from the pandemic will help improve human rights within the prison population going forward after the pandemic. I'm certainly hopeful it will.
Okay, thank you, Joe. So we'll come to Alan for that, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you for the question. The Human Rights Commission chairs the Independent Prison Monitoring Advisory Group for the Chief Inspector of Prisons in Scotland, and has done since the inception of Independent Prison Monitoring 5 years ago. And that's given the Commission a unique platform in which to have an oversight of the human rights obligations as applied to those people who are in prison at the moment. On the 20th of March of this year, the European Committee for the Prevention of Torture, Inhuman and Degrading and Ill Treatment, the CPT, who had in fact visited Scotland's prisons in 2018 and 2019, most recently, issued a statement of principles as applicable to all member states across the Council of Europe. And that statement of principles included that there were a number of fundamental rights that should be afforded to all persons in prison custody during the pandemic and during a period when increased restrictions were placed upon them. And those fundamental rights included time out of cell, a minimum of access to 1 hour of outdoor exercise every day, appropriate access to soap and water and to showers, access to telephone communication, and access to healthcare. And during the pandemic, as a commission, we have been involved in a series of meetings with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, where we have outlined our concerns in relation to where we believe that not all of those rights are being fully respected across all of Scotland's prisons, particularly in relation to those prisoners who have had to self-isolate on account of being, first of all, being symptomatic and then probably perhaps being confirmed with COVID, and those who have been in close contact. One of the big challenges, as we know, is that one of the risks for COVID transmission is being in an environment near someone who has been affected. And Scotland's prisons population at the end of last week was around 7,400, we have, I understand, less than 7,000 cells. And that means that a number of people are having to share cells, often cells designed to accommodate one person, which are now accommodating more than one person. And that undoubtedly increases the risk of an individual being exposed to COVID. COVID has affected not only prisoners, but prison staff. Staffing numbers have been reduced in Scotland's prisons as a result of staff having to self-isolate, some staff having to shield. And what we have found is that, with concern, there are a considerable number of instances whereby prisoners have been locked in their cells for 24 hours a day for a number of days, and in a few instances for a number of weeks, without access to showers or outdoor exercise. The situation in relation to maintaining contact with families has much improved due to the introduction of mobile telephones in cells. And that's been absolutely fantastic. And we welcome that. At the beginning of the pandemic, the government introduced emergency powers, which caused the numbers to be reduced in prison. At the beginning of the pandemic, we had around 8,000 people in prison. That dropped to just under 7,000, I understand. And now the numbers, with court activity resuming, the numbers are creeping up again. Around a quarter of all those in prison are in remand, and in fact, in some prisons, the percentage of remand is far greater than that. And many of these people in remand, when their case comes to trial, they will not return to prison because they will have been found not guilty, or they'll have been given a custodial sentence, which is deemed to be already served by dint of the fact that they've already spent on remand. Well, I think, thanks to the engagement that the Commission have had with the prison service, with government, and also the engagement of the Chief Inspector of Prisons, I think that the human rights of those who live and work in prisons has been given a platform previously that didn't have the same prominence, perhaps, pre-pandemic. One of the big challenges, to be honest, is that prison amendment rules were introduced in the early part of the pandemic, which gives governors wide-ranging powers, to be honest, to restrict the activities that are on offer. And one of the frustrations that the Commission have had is that the Scottish Prison Service are unable to tell us as to what extent the amendment powers, the amended regulations, are being used in each and every establishment. So I hope that's a helpful overview, but I'm very happy to take further specific follow-on questions, if that would be of assistance.
Thank you, Alan. If I can go back to Joe now, please, Joe.
Yeah, no, thanks very much for that. That's been really helpful. I mean, I guess the figures you talked about in terms of the number of cells and the number of prisoners, we all know that we have a higher proportion of our population in prison than other countries, and I guess that we need to look to you to help us keep a focus on reducing that number in order to, and from a human rights basis, for those who do need to be in prison. Obviously, there's an imbalance there in terms of if we've got more prisoners than we have capacity in order to protect people's humans and protect people's human rights as part of that process. I can see Mary Fee, because I know this is an area that Mary Fee is really, really interested in, so she's desperate to come in and talk a little on this, so I'll maybe hand back to you, convener, so that she can do so.
So if I could just ask any members, remember I can't see you all, so anyone wishing to come in, if you type an R in the chat box, and meantime, if I could just ask Alan to expand a bit on the what you said there about amendment powers and not being able to get the information about, you know, what's being used. That would feel like a pretty sort of fundamental safeguard that we would where, you know, people's rights are being limited, that we're able to understand to what extent and how. Could you say a bit more about that before I bring in Mary, please?
Sure. Prison amendment rules were introduced, if my memory serves me correctly, I think in May of last year. And these rules give governors quite far-ranging powers to restrict, for example, initially those powers were about restricting access, for example, to washing facilities, restricting or if there were challenges in the range of foods being made available that prisoners might time out of cell. And they have since been amended. They also allow governors to confine persons to their cells for public health reasons. However, when we have asked the prison service for information to what extent these powers are individually being applied and used by governors across each of Scotland's 15 prisons, that information has not been available to us. And the information as made public by the Scottish Prison Service, for example, in relation to the number of persons being isolated because of either being symptomatic or being in close contact with a person who's tested positive for COVID-19, that information is available on a Scotland-wide basis only, rather than an individual prison establishment basis. And to that extent, we really, there's a lack of transparency as to how the pandemic is being managed in individual establishments, particularly with reference to persons being confined to their cells in accordance with the amended prison rules. And that's been a challenge, because what we found, what we understand to be the situation, is that has varied from prison to prison. And for example, in some prisons, some smaller prisons, for example, at Inverness, during the pandemic, the amount of time that prisoners have been able to have outside themselves engaged in purposeful activity has been much greater than, for example, in Berlin, in Edinburgh, in Addiewell. So in a number of respects, we as a commission have a concern that, to an extent, how prisoners' rights are being restricted across the 15 different prisons in Scotland is somewhat unclear. So I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, that is helpful. And I did sort of wonder, on a practical level, if public health advice to the general population is to take fresh air and to wash regularly, it would feel that you're not only you know, restricting rights, you're actually perhaps exacerbating harm with some of these actions. So I think, you know, that is concerning to hear.
Absolutely, because a number of prisoners have in fact been subject to de facto solitary confinement for periods of time. So a few prisoners for a couple of weeks, and to not be allowed to leave the room in which you're living, which often has a window that doesn't open, cannot be good for physical or mental health.
Okay, thank you. If I could bring in Mary Fee now, please.
Thank you, convener. The update that you've given us about the situation in prisons has been really, really useful. I convened a cross-party group on families affected by imprisonment in the Parliament, and although I am not standing at the election in May, I hope that the cross-party group would continue, and it would be really good if the cross-party group could invite you along to one of the meetings next session. to talk about the work that you do with prisons and the prison population. But there's a couple of things that have been raised by members of the cross-party group in relation to prison visiting. And I don't know if you've picked up on this as well, but there have been concerns about the availability of virtual visits, how those virtual visits are planned and managed, about prisoners being able to maintain contact, particularly with young children, because prisoners' relationships with children are very, very important, not only to them in prison, but also when they leave prison. And there has been a fragmentation of that ongoing relationship that a prisoner can have with their family. It's also been raised to me as a convener of the cross-party group that, that there has been almost a lack of communication about the health and well-being of prisoners, and there hasn't been a kind of ongoing communication with their family about what's happening in the prison, the situation within the prison, and how that's going to develop. And I don't know if you're able to comment on this, but another issue that has been raised is where physical visits can take place, given the situation with transport. Some families have had great difficulty in being able to visit their family member, and there has been a lack of support to help that person actually physically visit the prison. And I don't know if that's issues that you have also been made aware of, and I'd be keen to hear your comments on that.
Thank you, Mary. If we go to Alan for those. Yeah.
Thank you for the question. The issue of virtual visits and how many prisoners have been able to access these is an issue that, as a commission, we have been aware of, as has the Chief Inspector of Prisons. And when we look at the number of virtual visits that have actually taken place, again, there are numbers available in respect of across Scotland, the number of opportunities there have been for virtual visits. But actually, what we don't know is how many prisoners have been able to participate in one virtual visit or two, three, or more virtual visits. So, the picture is incredibly unclear. And our understanding is that the virtual visits, they cannot take place in an individual's cell. They have to take place in a designated facility within the prison. And on account of the regime being a restricted regime, there are real challenges in prisoners being able to access lots and in staff being available to undertake the necessary escorting of the prisoners to the virtual visit facility. So yes, I think that undoubtedly there are people in prison who are very much missing the opportunity to engage with their family and friends. The issue of transport in relation to and the issue of physical visits, again, as a real challenge, and there is this balance to be struck between the stay at home message in relation to protecting public health and undertaking those journeys which are essential. And my personal view is that it is essential that those and their families, that every opportunity is taken to maintain family contact, because by maintaining family contact, we know that that is a positive in relation to reducing recidivism in the longer term among those who are currently in prison.
Thank you. I suppose we'd probably want to note as well that when we talk about prisoners not having contact, actually, I think it's helpful to reverse that sometimes and say that there are children not having contact with our parents, which is and you know, at a time when it's very difficult for our children and young people anyway, that's a hardship that they're facing. Okay, I'm going to move us along now to Alexander Stewart's questions, please.
Thank you, Convener. Judith, you gave a very good overview at the beginning of your evidence session this morning about what was happening and how disadvantaged different groups of people had managed the pandemic and the impact that it had on them. And we've already discussed today about decisions having to be made quite quickly to ensure that we were keeping pace with the pandemic as it spread and the difficulties that people's lives had to endure because of that. So can I ask you, on balance, do you think the Scottish Government undertook sufficient equalities and human rights impact assessments on legislation and on policy changes?
Thank you for that question. I think on balance is an interesting term. I think it was patchy is my honest answer to that. I think there was some good practice. I think practice improved. I think people became more cognizant as we went through the process and that continues. And in some of the key areas we were met with it. In fact, to be honest, most of them, all of them, I think, probably the ones we actively engaged in, we met with at the very least definite. We need to know about this. We need to know about this. We need to know about this, and consider this more. I would say there have been instances, Alan has referred to them, where in order to do the work we need to do or we would want to do, where I would say there's maybe a reluctance to provide the data or to be transparent. That continues to be an issue. So I would say, on balance, yes. I wouldn't say there's been systematic, thorough, really coherent equalities and human rights impact assessments on every decision that has been made in relation to the pandemic. I couldn't say that, to be honest. But do I think, in broad terms, that consideration has been given to human rights? Yes, I do. Do I think more could be done? Yes, I do, obviously. And I also, we are also very cognizant of the very, and the First Minister says this pretty much every day, the tough choices that are having to be made. And this is exactly, in some respects, the kind of scenario that human rights were designed for. They were designed to enable people to weigh up the harms, actually. And to look at things from a responsible perspective, a legal perspective, to make decisions based on the law, and based on how human rights play out. So I do think there's more to do. I mean, absolutely think that. Particularly when it comes to the engagement of people, vulnerable groups. And as we've understood more about the impacts of the pandemic, we've understood more about how Black and minority ethnic communities are affected, have been affected. We've understood more about how people with disabilities have been affected. We could have understood that earlier. We could have understood that if we'd asked those questions to those individuals up front and really built our processes on that. So I suppose I would give that honest answer of, yes, I think good work has happened, and yes, I think more can happen. There's more to do.
Thank you for that frank response, Judith. Because as you say, it's a balancing act to ensure that you have the rights and responsibilities, and individuals and organisations need to be protected, but at the same time, they have also got some rights themselves in this whole process. So, if I can ask Dr. Allen, the role that you have had in this whole process, do you believe that you, as a commissioner, etc., have had the opportunity to be based and to being consulted? You talked about what's happening in the prison service, but are there other areas across the sectors that you feel that there are still gaps that require to be looked at and lessons that need to be learned from this whole process to ensure that we do encapsulate and support individuals in ensuring that their rights are protected?
Thank you very much for the question. The Commission feels that it has been helpful in relation to the rights of people in prison, that we have been able to have open dialogue with colleagues in the Scottish Prison Service and with a Scottish Government. You asked about broader questions and are there other lessons to be learned? And I think we're aware that in relation to access to healthcare services and the provision of healthcare services during the COVID pandemic, much effort has been made in relation to the provision of services as they directly relate to people infected with COVID. Health boards across Scotland have had to reconfigure their services to become COVID responsive. Unfortunately, that has meant that a number of services have not been able to be provided for patients as they ordinarily would have done. And generally speaking, there's actually been a lack of engagement with patient groups and with patients themselves as to what their priorities might be. And I think it's within the health service, there's a focus on urgent care. What is urgent for one patient may be not wholly in keeping with what health providers and our hospitals have categorised as urgent care. So I think participation and the discussion around rights has and access to rights has been somewhat more limited than it could and should have been. And I think we have to do better at engaging, there being clearer and more open dialogue between duty bearers and the rights holders themselves. We as citizens, as patients, as people who have our freedoms restricted as older people in care homes or younger people in care homes. I think there needs to be a much clearer recognition that rights holders themselves can usefully engage in the conversations that need to take place around prioritisation.
And you've identified that the health is an area that there may have been some lessons that need to be learned how things progress. But can I ask, when you're looking at health, one of the big issues that we've heard on the general population has been the possible of mental health. But when you're dealing with that in a prison environment as well, has there been gaps within that sector to support and ensure that the individuals who are incarcerated are being supported, but also that the broader family base that Mary Fee talked about, ensuring that there's a support mechanism there for them with individuals who do have that mental capacity or have some difficulties with their mental health?
Within each of Scotland's prisons, there are multidisciplinary mental health teams. What we have found in relation to ways of working since the start of the pandemic is that, by and large, there are many fewer face-to-face interventions between staff generally, and including healthcare staff and individual prisoners, individual patients. And while in-cell resources can be made available, in relation to the provision of mental health and well-being, they at times can be no substitute for a face-to-face, in-person conversation and intervention. We've seen that the health service generally, there has been a move towards remote consulting. That remote consulting, that interaction, has also been affected in a number of our prisons. And when we lock people in their rooms and their cells for a longer period of time, inevitably, that will lead to a deterioration in the mental health and well-being. And because of the challenges with contact, with virtual visits and with in-person visits, that has caused
people in prison to be worried about themselves, worried about their families, but also families outside to be equally concerned about the health and well-being of their mums, their dads, their aunts, their uncles, their brothers, sisters in prison.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Mary, can I come to you for your question about the task force?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Judith. I wonder if you could perhaps give us an update on the work of the National Task Force on Human Rights Leadership.
I certainly can. Yeah, thank you for that. So, as you will be aware, the Commission is a member of the National Task Force, which is co-chaired by the former chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission, Professor Alan Miller, and Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville. We are nearing the end of our process. I say that with a smile because, particularly in the last 3 months, that's been a very intense period. Some of the work of, like so much else, some of the work of the task force was had to be put on hold as the real force of the pandemic was being felt right across government and by the organisations who were participating in the task force. So, however, we are still on track to complete the report before the end of this parliamentary term. The Commission ourselves have been involved in very much in really supporting understanding around economic, social, cultural rights, the right to a healthy environment, and then looking at how those rights can be incorporated into Scots law and also the right under the additional treaties of CEDAW, CERD and the CRPD. I can unpack those names if that's necessary in the official record. So that work is ongoing. We've had, I would say, given the pandemic, and it's within this context, really quite significant engagement across Scotland with civil society organisations that's one of the benefits of remote operating, as I'm sure you've found yourselves, is that you can speak to people in all corners of the country without having to do that travel thing or have those issues. That's been a good side. Downside is that people who haven't got access to the technology obviously find that much harder to engage. So you've got swings and roundabouts there. So we've had, I would say, extensive engagement on a whole range of issues in relation to the task force process of really, unpacking what the implications are of incorporating these treaties into Scots law. But that has been a hugely positive process and helped the task force to understand what's at stake, what's required. And then I would say for me, a key part of that has been what we've called the kind of a bit of more public engagement with rights holders, specifically people for whom engaging in these conversations on a professional basis is not happening, is not an option. We worked with the Human Rights Consortium in Scotland to develop a suite of materials called All Our Rights in Law to enable people to anybody actually to really have join the conversation about what these rights mean and how they would better want to see them realised in Scotland. And I suppose I don't think it will come as a surprise to this committee to hear that, as well as really people feeling they wanted information about their rights, that's a core aspect of empowerment. It's a core aspect of the human rights framework, is that people, there's a responsibility and duty there is to give people information about their rights. They want to know that when something goes wrong, they can access justice quickly, affordably, effectively, in a way that works for them. And that's the biggest gap in Scotland, in my view, to be perfectly honest. Our strategic priorities reflect that, in that we recognise the access to justice gaps that we have in law in Scotland, or we don't have in law in Scotland, and the processes and means for which people accessing justice around their rights are very, very time consuming. Often, if something goes to court, very expensive. Take ages, and most people can't do that. The reality is actually that they're absolutely not enabled to go through any kind of justice process. We have complaints mechanisms. They are robust, they're effective at that level, but they're often not fully reflective of the human rights framework. They don't necessarily take people's rights into account in an explicit way. And so we've been that's been a key topic at the task force in terms of really unpacking, well, how can we make those rights more accessible to people?
That was very helpful, Judith. And I think given the situation that we've been in the last year, it is remarkable that you're on track to finish that piece of work before the end of this parliamentary session. But I suppose on the back of that, there's a couple of things I wanted to ask you. So that piece of work is completed. How will you continue that work as we go forward? And what have you learned, given that we've been in a pandemic for the last year? What have you learned that will build into your work going forward and how we need to change and adapt to make sure people can actually achieve their rights?
So I'll answer the second one first, if that's okay. In terms of what we've learned, I mean, that's a really good question. And I'll be honest, I don't think we've really fully thought that through. I think there is things, but what I can say is an immediate response. And I mean, I don't know why I'm saying this as a lesson, because I know it intrinsically, but it's that constant sense of, if you talk to people whose rights are affected, you get a much better answer to the question. So again, we reach out, we have the conversation, we draw on that experience, we hear how people are, and we for me, I mean, now this is a personal comment actually, but I know it applies across policy making. When that is heard, the response necessarily has to be completely different. And I know the committee's been working on the CRC bill and a range of, when you hear from children and young people, when you hear from key stakeholders who are right are being affected by things, it changes the dynamic, it changes your understanding, and it changes the outcome and the response. And so for me, that continues to be a lesson that I continue to learn, and that I think I see other people learn, not quite daily, sadly, but repeatedly. And I think that is also something that we need to keep factoring into our thinking going forward. It's like how it putting time, energy and resources into ensuring that participation is enabled, is meaningful and is influencing the outcome. So that's really important. Your second answer, I suppose, flows from that, which is going forward. You know, what's going to happen going forward? Obviously, I mean, what happens politically, I'm not... not for me to comment on, but from a Commission perspective, again, I come back to our strategy. This is one of our key strategic priorities for over this period, and not just about the task force, because we know that when you speak to people about their rights, the first things they talk about are their economic and social rights. Mm. And increasingly in this context, what's happening in relation to climate change and climate justice. So, and particularly obviously when you're talking to young people around these issues. And so we've been very pleased to be part of the conversations around incorporating or bringing the right to a healthy environment into that process. Now, we will continue to engage in whatever process comes after, but I think we will also, that's important, it's important that the Commission informs that and is informed by it, but we will also, I think, continue to work on that capacity building more broadly. So capacity building within civil society organisations, within public authorities, for whom if this legislation comes to pass and is brought into law, will really have to be able to factor all that understanding into their thinking and policy making. In the same way as the discussion around the CRC has had, the incorporation of the Convention on the Rights of the Child has had, policymakers, duty bearers, public authorities in Scotland are I would say, genuinely waking up to the fact, I mean, a lot of it is not new, that's the reality, but really, in order to really be competent, be on top of these issues, they're going to have to do the work, understand what's at stake, and bring that much more into their thinking, their practice, and it is part of the Commission's role to support that happening, and we're very conscious of that. However, I would also say we're very conscious of our capacity to do that is constrained, very much by our size, and that's been also part of the conversations of the resourcing of the Commission and other organisations to do that work needs to also be factored into the process going forward.
That's very helpful. Thank you, Judith, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mary. Just to help out the official report there, I note that we've got a message in the chat box there from Alec Cole-Hamilton that he's had to leave the meeting and won't be coming back. Okay. The UK government is reviewing the Human Rights Act at the moment. I wonder if if the Commission will be submitting a response to that review, and if you're in a position to share some reflections with committee on that. Judith, I'll come to you.
Thank you. Yes, we are. We are submitting to the review, and very much in the perspective of the impact that the Act has had in Scotland, as you would expect, but also from the perspective of the long-standing Commission perspective, that the Human Rights Act has been a very key piece of legislation in terms of driving change in relation to people's rights on the ground in communities. The conversation we've just been having around prisons is, some of that is underpinned by the Human Rights Act. So it's a very important piece of domestic law. It helps people enforce their rights in the UK. That's the key. That sense of bringing rights home is a real thing, and enables people to proactively engage domestically around their rights. That's, again, just in terms of the conversation I've just been talking about in relation to economic social rights, that is people's sense of being able to access their rights or get access to justice if their rights are infringed is very acute, and it applies just as much for civil and political rights as it does for economic and social rights. So I think that's a very important aspect. And the reality is that people in Scotland want to see rights strengthened. They want to see their rights being strengthened going forward, and that's partly why we're engaging in the task force process. So from our perspective, the Human Rights Act, and really around the world actually, the Human Rights Act is hailed as a very positive piece of domestic legislation in terms of incorporating rights. So from our perspective, we don't think it requires to be changed. We think it is a good piece of legislation. It delivers in various ways, that's our view. But we will be submitting, and that we will publish that submission. It's not finalised yet, but it will have a much more detailed analysis of the legal implications.
Thank you, that's helpful. Just to go back to your strategic plan for a second, it talks of working with the Scottish Parliament to help Parliament become a guarantor of human rights. Looking forward to the next session, how do you see that working? What can the next Parliament do more of or better?
Thank you for asking that question. Great question. I think in the course of this session, there's been this committee. Obviously, you've done a full inquiry and full report into that process. Much of that work still stands. It's still very relevant. And I'll give you a brief update as to where some of that is from the Commission's perspective. But what I would also say is what I would hope to see from the next Parliament is that the human rights component of the Equality and Human Rights Committee remains. It remains alive and well and is resourced. And so that explicit statement of human rights, remains within the committee and is taken into the next sessions. That's one key thing from my perspective. I think that's been really advantageous within the Parliament. I think it's driven an increase in understanding and the necessity to engage with human rights. I would say more needs to be done. And one of the things that we have been piloting, I think some committee members or some previous committee members would have been part of, is some of the training work that we've done with MSPs. You'll know that I can't remember the exact numbers of MSPs who participated, but we had a schedule of three sessions, training sessions on different aspects of the human rights framework. very much orientated to, you know, directly to training MSPs and what they have to contend with and deal with as they go through both, you know, drawing up legislation and dealing with constituency issues. We only managed to have two of those sessions done before the pandemic hit, and then it became really impossible to do the third one. But that was very much trialing, piloting, bespoke training for MSPs so that we could potentially roll that out as part of the induction process for new MSPs. So that's still the plan. And we're in early discussions, I would say, with the Parliament over how we can do that over into the next session. And my understanding is that, again, there's, because of the pandemic and working remotely, that, you know, there's obviously some challenges around that, and what is actually going to be an induction training for new MSPs is being modified or tailored to the circumstances. That's completely understandable, but we're very much in the frame as being, as you know, ensuring for new MSPs that they get that sort of induction process into the rights framework and increased understanding, so that they're coming to the role with that perspective. I would say there's still an ongoing challenge to work with existing MSPs. Obviously, it won't be known how many are new and how many are returning. And we're really keen to, as much as we can, enable that training to happen with everybody. In as much as our citizens want to know their rights, we're very much aware that MSPs have a huge responsibility in discharging that. And I suppose as we move, what I've seen is that as you've engaged around the key rights issues, you know, like the incorporation of the Convention of the Rights of the Child, awareness and understanding around rights grows all the time. I've seen it as we've, and I think, you know, we've been heavily involved in the financial redress scheme and taking forward the work on historic abuse and providing financial redress for survivors of historic abuse. Again, that's very much built on the human rights framework, on what access to remedy looks like, what fair remedy looks like from a human rights perspective, and enabling survivors to have their space within that discussion really meaningfully, and for that to guide process. And as that's happened, you can see people's understanding of people's rights growing as they've gone on. So I think that capacity building amongst MSPs is really important part of that. And I would also say that if the Parliament does embark on a process of incorporating, a large number of treaties going forward, then that in and of itself will bring about increased capacity building, but also the recognition that resources need dedicated and specific and expert resources need to be put into this from a parliamentary perspective. I think that was one of the recommendations of your report, committee report, and that still remains outstanding.
Thank you, Judith. Alan, I'm conscious you didn't get a chance to come in there. If you have anything to add on either the Human Rights Act or what more Parliament can do as a guarantor, I'm happy to hear from you before we move on to the next question. Or are you content?
No, I'm content. I mean, I think that the Commission, what we're keen to see in relation to the review of the Human Rights Act is that there'll be no regression. So the Human Rights Act has been but a force for positive. Let's continue that direction.
Thank you. That's helpful. I'm going to go to Alison Harris now, who's been waiting very patiently. Alison.
Thank you. And Sod's Law, my computer has just gone off. Hold on 2 seconds, I'll just get to my question. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Actually, convener, this is not going well. I'm sorry, I don't know what's happened.
Would it be helpful if I pick up the area you were going to ask?
Would you mind in relation to budgeting? It's just, I have got it now, convener. Here we are. That's it. I'm here. Thank you. Sorry about that, committee. Right, so the committee has made calls this session for the development of human rights budgeting. The recent Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement outlines the 10 key risks to progressing national outcomes as a result of COVID-19 pandemic and the EU exit, and considers
how policy and activity funded by the budget will respond to these challenges. So I would like to ask you if you support this approach and whether you think the Scottish Government is making progress in equality and human rights budgeting. I know we did, I think Judith mentioned budgeting earlier on, but I would just like to expand and ask this question. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Alison. Judith, do you any more remarks on equalities and human rights budget?
Yes, inevitably I do. So we've, I think there's a lot of work to do in this area. That's not to say that I don't think work has been done. I do. I think we are now the Commission is now a member represented on the Equality Budget Advisory Group, and so that's one of the reasons you will be seeing increased referencing of human rights in the Equality Statement around the budget. But I suppose the key point is it can't stay in the Equality Statement, and that narrative around human rights and responding to human rights obligations from a budgetary perspective is a really key part of the Parliament being a guarantor at one level, but also government fulfilling its state obligations to the treaties that it signed up. So that process, there's as I say, some work has happened. We've engaged quite extensively with some of the finance teams, and particularly through the Equality Budget Advisory Group, around that human rights conversation and what the implications of really bringing human rights into that budget process as it pans out. Now, some of you will be aware of a report that we produced around the Open Budget Initiative, which does an analysis of budget processes, that's done at a state level. So the UK would be the state in our instance, but the Commission worked with a team of others to really look at how Scotland does their process using the same measurements as the Global Open Budget Initiative. And it was fortunate on one level in that when we started that, it was the year we were able to use was prior to the recommendations that had come out of the Parliament's own review of the budget process, all of which reference the need for more participation, wider ability to scrutinise from all committee perspectives. You know, there's a whole unpacking of how the budget process could be improved. But that remains relevant, important from a human rights perspective, and very, very apposite in terms of the kind of changes that we would want to see going forward. But the real gift, or the real prize, I suppose, from a budget perspective, is what happens upstream of the budget. It's the conversation that takes place in the policy rooms and the decision making around what the money is going to be spent on that actually has the biggest impact on human rights, I would say. So it's the policy analysis up front that requires that human rights built into it. So if we're making a decision about social security payments, for example, and the scope of the budget in relation to social security payments, that we're doing that really with a fundamental human rights analysis in play, in the room, on the table, like what, you know, really understanding with all the data that, you know, some of the issues we've described in relation to prisons, all the data there, enabled to inform decision making around who's most vulnerable, who's most effective. Do we know the answers to the questions as who's winning and who's losing out of these dynamics? We know women lose more out of social security processes. We know children don't benefit in key ways. Are we factoring that knowledge into our decision making going forward? That policy bit up front then has the biggest chance of influencing how the budget. But the other key question is, are we able to follow the money? Do we know what happens to the money? and that's, you know, that's one of the real challenges the Commission has found, and not just the Commission, because again, we've also seen other organisations pick up these tools and use them in their own processes, like the Poverty and Inequality Commission, really scrutinising how do we look at the child poverty targets and how do we, for example, how do we track how the money is being spent? It's frankly at the moment almost impossible, and so if not impossible, and so that those process, that transparency, enabling that analysis has to be a key part of how we see that work unpacking going forward. So there's a lot in that. I would say in this particular area, it's a marathon, not a sprint. You know, it will take time for all of that to unfold. But really, I suppose we would like to see. I think they're there, but I think it could be strengthened. commitment to embracing that approach going forward, so that you're actually, you as a committee, for example, are able to track, are we spending what we need to spend in order to achieve the outcomes that we want to achieve from a human rights perspective?
Thank you, that's helpful. Alison.
Yeah, no, I found that actually very interesting, Judith, because obviously, you know, the tracking of the money is absolutely essential to measuring the outcomes. And if you are not able to do that, then, you know, it's actually very worrying. So, but thank you. Your comments were very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Alison. And no other member has indicated they wish to speak. So that concludes our evidence session. I'd like to thank Judith Robertson, Chair of Scottish Human Rights Commission, and Dr. Alan Mitchell, Commissioner. It's been a really full and informative session. We appreciate your time and all the work that you are doing. So that concludes the public part of our meeting. The committee will next meet on the 4th of March, where we'll take evidence from the Minister for Older People and Equalities. Also currently scheduled for that date is a debate on International Women's Day 2021. Committee will now move over to Microsoft Teams for consideration of items 3 and 4. So I close the public part of this meeting.